couple people in. Hello to everyone coming in. Thank you all for joining us tonight for our event with Marissa Crawford and Megan Milks and several other avid readers of the Babysitters Club. We Are the Babysitters Club is their essay collection. It is essays and artwork from grown-up readers. And just before we get into that, I would like to make a few announcements for Green Apple. Our upcoming events are on Monday, July 12th, we will have Violet Cooper Smith joining us to discuss her latest novel, Build Your House Around My Body, with Rachel Kong. And on Wednesday, July 14th, Lawrence Jackson Hyman and Bernice Murphy discuss their work on the letters of Shirley Jackson, a collection of never before published letters from the renowned San Francisco writer. And tonight we are very excited for this large panel. And our hosts are Marissa Crawford and Megan Milks. Marissa Crawford's writing on pop culture, art, and feminism has appeared in Harper's Bazaar, The Nation, Hyperallergic, Vice, and elsewhere. She is the author of two collections of poetry, Reversible and The Haunted House, both from Switchback Books, and the founder of the feminist literary website Weird Sister. Megan Milks is the author of Margaret and the Mystery of the Missing Body and Slug and Other Stories, forthcoming from Feminist Press, as well as Tori Amos' Bootleg Web Ring, forthcoming from Instar Books. Enjoy the show, everyone.
Thank you so much, Erica. Thank you all so much for being here. Thank you to Green Apple for hosting. We're big fans of Green Apple, definitely spent a lot of time there when I lived in San Francisco. So please support this amazing independent bookstore. Please buy books, not just our book, but all of the books from them. And thank you also to Chicago Review Press and our agent, Rach Crawford, for all their support on this project. And thank you again for being here. We're so excited.
We are, of course, very pleased to be celebrating the release of We Are the Babysitters Club, which is a collection of 24 essays and artworks reflecting on the legacy of Anne M. Martin's iconic series. And Marissa and I are gonna start things off by just reading a short excerpt from our introduction for the book, and then we'll turn it over to our contributors who are here with us tonight.
Awesome. So we are gonna just jump into the introduction. In 1986, the first ever meeting of the Babysitters Club was called to order in a messy Stony Brook, Connecticut bedroom, strewn with ringdings, scrunchies, a landline phone, and hollowed out books stuffed with licorice and milk duds. Christy, Claudia, Stacy, and Marianne launched the club that birthed an entire generation of loyal, dare we say, obsessive readers.
From the Babysitters Club number one, Christie's Great Idea, to number 131, The Fire at Marianne's House, Anne M. Martin's wildly popular book series lasted 13 years, the age of its five core characters, who remained forever frozen in eighth grade, and a remarkably long life for a children's series. It spawned several spin-offs, including the BSC Mysteries and Babysitter's Little Sister, not to mention a TV show, a feature film, and a very riveting board game. The series featured more than 300 titles and generated close to 200 million printed copies, copies that millions of readers like us devoured with near religious fervor in the 1980s and 90s. We snatched up each new title at our schools, scholastic book fairs, and libraries, savoring every new adventure and crafted our outfits, our handwriting, and our personalities to mirror our favorite characters, or quietly formed secret crushes on them.
35 years later, we're all grown up, but we've never stopped thinking about the BSC, and we're far from alone. While we couldn't join the Babysitters Club as much as we may have wanted to at the time, we've become proud members of a different club, a whole generation of adults who grew up under the well-appointed care of these seven extremely reliable babysitters, and were impacted by the series in so many ways. Whether it's talking with our friends about how they use the new graphic novels to teach their kids about blended families, or still aspiring to Claudia's iconic style, it's become clear to us that the BSC has remained an influential presence in many of our lives.
As we've watched various homages unfolding over the past decade or so, from Kim Hutt Mayhew's blog cataloging the book's sartorial style, What Claudia Wore, to a whole slew of comics and podcasts, and now a Netflix BSC adaptation, we wanted to carve out a space to give this series the celebration and consideration it deserves. After all, media aimed at young girls is so often dismissed as frivolous. But as Maria Sachiko Sassiri of the Data Sitters Club writes about the BSC books, in giving our attention to texts that meant so much to so many readers as they charted their various ways toward adulthood, we recognize that these books, these structures, and these readers are as important to our world as financial models, canonical literature, and scientific breakthroughs. The essays and artwork in this book take a closer look at how Anna Martin's series shaped our ideas about gender, politics, friendship, family, fashion, and beyond. And we're very pleased to have six of our contributors with us tonight. Gabrielle Moss, Siobhan Gallagher, Chante Griffin, Miriam Gurba, Sue Ding, and Frankie Thomas. So we're gonna start things off with Gabrielle Moss. Gabrielle Moss is the author of Paperback Crush, the totally radical history of 80s and 90s teen fiction. Really a very excellent book, highly recommended. Her work has appeared in The New Yorker, BuzzFeed, GQ.com, The Daily Beast, Refinery29, and many other outlets. Hi, Gabby. Thanks for being here. I'll mute myself now.
Hi, everybody. Wanted to up top apologize for this kind of intense, like expressionistic cabinet of Dr. Caligari lighting, and also say that I just got a message across my computer that said, internet connection unstable, which I think you'll all agree adds an exciting little bit of danger to the evening. So if I suddenly disappear, that is why, but I hope I don't. Thank you all for coming. So my essay is called From Girlfriends to Monster Sitters, How the BSC Spawned a Whole Moral Universe. And for any of you who are BSC fans from back in the day, you may recall the many, many knockoffs that the series inspired. You know, you would walk into B. Dalton and there would be a ton of series called like the Spittin' Babies Club, the, you know, hanging around little kids party. You know, cheap knockoffs that were basically created in a boardroom to cash in on the craze that the Babysitter's Club legitimately created in young adult fiction. But what I would like to argue is that those books are an important part of its legacy. Stay with me. So, like many unpopular children, I spent most of my childhood dreaming about the future. And like many children who spend a lot of time dreaming about the future, almost all of my future predictions turned out to be wrong. Despite my fervent second grade hopes, I don't have a robot butler, we're still waiting for our flying cars, and for whatever reason, I never ended up getting married to Jason Priestley. I'm going to chalk that one up to scheduling issues. However, I did get one prediction right. The Babysitter's Club actually did stay popular forever. Honestly, at the time, the odds seemed better for the Jason Priestley thing. Trends come and go in general, but in children's book publishing, they come and go especially hard. One day, every single YA book is about a post-apocalyptic future where only one chosen girl has the power to save everything. And then the next day, every book is a charming, realistic romance novel, and that chosen one is dragging her crossbow straight to the discount bin. It is the way of young adult fiction, a literary culture that has, since its inception in the 1940s, been strongly governed by trends. From the wholesome froth of what YA scholars refer to as the malt shop books of the 1950s and 60s, to the social issue-focused problem novels of the 1970s, all the way to the apocalypto-fic of the 2010s and beyond. But decades after its debut, The Babysitter's Club has done more than simply stay popular, though it has stayed incredibly popular, racking up over $180 million in sales on more than 200 print volumes, two TV shows, one movie, and a line of vaguely American Girl-esque dolls. But for a whole generation of readers, The Babysitter's Club is something more than nostalgia. It's a series that expanded our understanding of life and ourselves. I mean, I don't have to explain that to you. You're the ones who decided to spend time reading this book and attending this reading, instead of cleaning your gutters or learning French or checking on what your kid is eating under the couch. It's just a cracker that fell there. It's fine. Keep reading. The Babysitter's Club earned this lasting legacy in part by making inclusive values and progressive beliefs part of the series's core. Values like honoring diverse voices and experiences, promoting empathy, and suggesting that girls make great leaders. These values were far from standard in young adult lit in 1986 when Christie's great idea first popped up on the scene. But today, they form the backbone of modern YA. Footnote, technically, The Babysitter's Club is categorized as middle grade fiction for slightly younger readers than YA. But among actual readers, these delineations are rarely observed, with young readers moving freely between middle grade and YA fare. Sweet Valley High and Babysitter's Club books shared readers, and BSC's influence can be felt in children's books for all age groups, from grade schoolers to teens. So, for the purposes of this essay, I am considering Babysitter's Club part of YA culture. If you don't like it, go sit on a Kid Kit. Back to the essay. Of course, this change can hardly be credited to Anne M. Martin alone. Countless YA writers, including many writers of color and writers of marginalized identities who never had a crack at the kind of mainstream mega success The Babysitter's Club enjoyed, created today's diverse and inclusive YA culture together. But the fact that The Babysitter's Club was the first major YA series to stress the importance of diverse identities, the first to examine classism, racism, and chronic health issues, as well as the first to say that running your own business and emotionally supporting your friends were activities at least as important as trying to get some random dude named Bruce's attention, has become a key part of a legacy now analyzed by publications as fancy as The New Yorker, The Feminist Legacy of the Babysitter's Club, 2016, and The Atlantic, The Legacy of the Babysitter's Club, 2012. But I think in order to truly understand The Babysitter's Club's legacy and how it made such an impact, we have to examine the knockoffs. You remember the knockoffs, right? Series like Susan Saunders' Sleepover Friends, Nicole Gray's Girlfriends, and even Susan Smith's Samantha Slade Monster Sitter that popped up in the wake of the BSC, cashing in with readers who had a sudden and insatiable hunger for books about girls doing stuff. Most of these books were written hastily with no greater goal than selling copies to a few confused parents who had exhausted their supply of actual BSC books. But they turned one series' messages into a trend, making them omnipresent within tween literature. These churned out knockoffs gave the original series' ideas about female friendship and inclusivity heft and widespread critical mass in the culture. And when something becomes a trend, goes from being singular to mass, it makes a deeper impact. It's like the difference between just the Beatles and the entire British invasion. The sheer mass of imitators helps reinforce the original's message, giving it greater reach. If every single book you pick up in Walden Books presents at least some version of the Babysitter's Club value,
looks like Gabby had some technical issues.
Shoot. So maybe we'll move on to our next reader and hopefully Gabby will be able to rejoin us. Oh, there she is. Hi, Gabby.
Jesus Christ, I was one line from the end of that. Let's just call it a day.
You can finish up. Go right ahead.
Those values more widely. They don't just become the vision of a single series. They become the standard. Good night and good luck, America.
Thank you so much. That piece is so amazing. I love like looking at the knockoffs and thinking about the moral universe they created so much. Thank you, Gabby. Our next reader is Sue Ding. Sue is a filmmaker and artist based in LA. Her most recent short film, The Claudia Kishi Club, was an official selection at South by Southwest and premiered on Netflix. If you haven't already, please go watch the Claudia Kishi Club. It is amazing. Sue also leads the XR Emerging Media Program at the Los Angeles Asian Pacific Film Festival and consults on interactive, immersive, and multi-platform projects. She is an alum of MIT's Open Documentary Lab and a Senior Civic Media Fellow at USC's Annenberg School for Communication and Journalism. Welcome, Sue.
Thank you. Hi, everyone. I'm going to read a selection of my essay about making the film and some of my personal connection to Claudia Kishi. So making the Claudia Kishi Club. As a kid, and here's the book. As a kid, I read voraciously. I lived vicariously through books, running away to the Metropolitan Museum of Art or befriending dragons or churning butter on the frontier. I encountered all kinds of people in these stories, but rarely came across characters of color. The books I read focused on white families in suburbia, white kids on adventures, and white knights in fantasy worlds. This seemed normal to me at the time. As an Asian American kid growing up in an extremely white town in upstate New York, I didn't encounter a lot of people who looked like me. But subconsciously, I craved representation. I was so desperate to be seen that I latched onto Spinelli from the animated TV show Recess with her straight black hair, a badass Asian tomboy. More than a decade later, I realized her name was Spinelli, and internet research confirmed she was 100% Italian American. Although, to be fair, many people seem to have been confused about this. When I did encounter an Asian character, they usually didn't get to be the protagonist or save the day, and they definitely didn't get to have a love interest. Often they were sidekicks or worse, stereotypes. Unattractive and robotic nerds, nefarious Chinatown gangsters, exotic geishas, and mystical elders who spoke like Yoda. Invisibility felt preferable to racial caricature. The cringe of bad Asian accents, squinty eyes, and buck teeth, me love you long time. In the rare books I read that centered the experiences of non-white characters, protagonists often seemed defined by their oppression. They were impoverished laborers, marginalized immigrants, victims of racism. Later, I appreciated the importance of these stories of struggle and resistance, but at the time, the characters in these books felt fundamentally other. Foreign and often historical, endlessly self-sacrificing in the face of tragic circumstances. I couldn't look around my town and imagine being friends with these characters, and I didn't see myself reflected in them. Their stories didn't make me feel empowered. If anything, they made me feel like more of an outsider. I longed for more exciting and glamorous role models, but above all else, I wanted to read about characters whose lives and concerns echoed my own. I idolized Christy Yamaguchi and Michelle Kwan, of course, but as someone who dreaded gym class, I could never really relate to their commitment to athletic achievement. Where were the characters of color who worried about math tests, hung out of the mall, and just wanted a date to the spring fling dance? I finally found what I was looking for at the Scholastic Book Fair, that most hallowed of school events. I still remember the colorful cartoon displays, glittering merch, and endless shelves of glossy paperbacks. I had no particular interest in babysitting, but as I reverently browsed through the books, something led me to pick up The Babysitter's Club number 2, Claudia and the Phantom Phone Calls. The cover illustration left Claudia's ethnicity somewhat ambiguous, but within the first few pages of the book, written in first person, Claudia explains that her last name is Kishi and her family is Japanese American. She also describes her love of mystery books and junk food, her huge crush on Trevor Sanborn, her passion for art, and her aversion to homework. In just a few pages, Claudia emerged as a fully fleshed out character, someone who brought enthusiasm and creativity to everything she pursued, who cared about her family but struggled with their expectations, and who was charting her own idiosyncratic path through life. In the first of many, many iconic Claudia outfit descriptions in the series, she writes, "Traditional clothing looks boring and is boring to put on, so I never wear it. I like bright colors and big patterns and funny touches, such as earrings made from feathers. Maybe this is because I'm an artist. Today, for instance, I'm wearing purple pants that stop just below my knees and are held up with suspenders, white tights with clocks on them, a purple plaid shirt with a matching hat, my high top sneakers, and lobster earrings. Clothes like these are my trademark." At a time when most kids, certainly me, were just trying to fit in, to not say or wear or do anything that would be made fun of, Claudia's impervious confidence was awe-inspiring. She was totally unafraid to be her unique and wacky self. Claudia was an instantly iconic character. Lots of young readers aspired to her self-assurance and her bold style and related to her academic struggles or her insecurity about her overachieving older sister. For many Asian Americans, though, Claudia was a revelation. Claudia was not only a rare Asian American protagonist, but she also defied stereotypical portrayals of Asian and non-white characters. She was popular, confident, fashionable. She wasn't a sidekick or a token person of color. And unlike many depictions of Asians as perpetual foreigners stuck in the past, Claudia was unmistakably a modern American teenager. While her Japanese heritage was an important part of her character, she wasn't defined only by her race. She felt like a fully realized human being and a protagonist of her own story. Claudia was a role model that I was desperately looking for. The fact that she was an aspiring artist further ensued my devotion. I had always loved art and dreamed of becoming a painter who also had a highly successful fashion line. But in art class and then in the museums we visited, most of the art I saw was created by white men. Reading about Claudia was an important early affirmation that I too could be an artist. Even though she was a fictional character and only in middle school, her art was never treated as an unimportant or lesser pursuit. Like the Kishis, my parents appreciated art, but felt it was more important to prioritize pragmatic subjects like math and science. Claudia's commitment to her art helped inspire me to stick to my convictions about pursuing a creative path, first as an art student and then as a documentary filmmaker. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Sue. And yeah, again, if you haven't seen the Claudia Kishi Club, it is on Netflix and you should go straight from this event to go watch it. Next up is Frankie Thomas. Frankie Thomas is the YA of yore columnist for the Paris Review. They are the author of the novella, The Showrunner, and they once appeared on PBS NewsHour to geek out about Latin. They hold an MFA in fiction from the Iowa Writers Workshop and live in New York City. Hi, Frankie. Thanks for being here.
Oh, thank you for having me. Can you hear me okay before I start reading?
Yep.
Okay. Hi, everybody. I am so happy to be here. So I'm going to do something a little bit different. I'm going to read a condensed version of my essay that appears in the book. So it will have a beginning and a middle and an end, but it's like a little mini version. So if you want to read the full version, read the book. But I just didn't want to leave you hanging. So I have whittled it down to a miniature reading size version. All right, I will begin. My essay is called, Could the Babysitter's Club Have Been More Gay? The Scholastic Industrial Complex would sooner have published a bomb-building manual than allow an openly gay book character in the 90s, but the paradigm shifted so rapidly in the mid-2000s that even I am occasionally tempted to judge the books of my childhood by the standards of subsequent decades, hence my long-held, largely irrational grudge against Anne M. Martin. When the news came out in 2016 that she was a lesbian, I was surprised by the uncomplicated rejoicing among my queer cohort, and then surprised by the force of my own resentment. My knee-jerk reaction, I'm not proud to say, was, so what? What did she ever do for us? To which the obvious rejoinder would be, she gave us Christy Thomas, you ungrateful idiot. When queer millennials look back fondly on the Babysitter's Club, it's usually with a focus on Christy. Even Anne M. Martin herself revealed in a 2014 interview that Christy was her favorite. No surprise there. The books incessantly reminded us in those exposition-laden early chapters that Christy was a tomboy, that she loved sports, loathed dresses and makeup, didn't need a bra, and the books were oddly fixated on this detail, didn't even have pierced ears. Christy, in short, was a lesbian-coded character, if there ever was one. But the coding went only so far. On a textual level, the series was constantly insisting on the babysitter's heterosexuality, their interest in boys, their attractiveness to boys, their availability to boys, and Christy was no exception. Christy's recurring love interest was the boy next door, Bart Taylor. "I have a crush on Bart," Christy informs the reader on the first page of Christy's Mystery Admirer, a book that ends with him kissing her at the school dance. In Snowbound, Bart is stranded overnight at Christie's, and Christie, in a panic, sets her alarm for 5:30 a.m. to give herself a makeover. She shaves her legs, blow dries and curls her hair, puts on mascara and blush. Much is made of how unusual this is for Christie, but Bart's approval makes it all worth it. I'm gonna read from the book. In the book, Christie narrates, Bart whispered to me, "You look beautiful, Christie." I relaxed. "Thanks," I said. Okay, I had made it. Bart had spent the night at my house. He was sitting next to me, telling me I was beautiful. That's the end of the excerpt. Snowbound 2 ends with Bart taking Christie to the school dance. School dances were held in seemingly every other book. A young reader could easily get the impression that life itself was a school dance and that you couldn't show up to it without an opposite sex date. Poor Anne M. Martin. It wasn't her fault, and it surely gave her no pleasure that her fictional universe was a vast heterosexual hellscape. How, in the 90s, could she and her ghostwriters possibly have gotten away with disturbing that universe? Except they almost did. There was a time when they came very close. In 1997, a new Babysitter's Club spin-off called California Diaries began to appear on shelves. The crossover character was Dawn Schaefer. The occasion for the spin-off? Her relocation from Connecticut to California. Despite Dawn's presence in the new series, its cover art signaled forcefully that it would not contain babysitting. Rejecting the original series' kiddie aesthetic of letter blocks and pastels, the California Diaries had matte covers with soft focus photographs of gorgeous, unsmiling teens. They were plunging into pool water or sprawling on disheveled bedsheets or gazing sadly into the distance. In a word, they were sexy, a quality heretofore alien to the BSC universe. The California Diaries were clearly for mature readers who had grown too cool for the Babysitter's Club. I was 10 years old and I was instantly hooked. I can only assume that Scholastic didn't think it through because the spin-off's built-in problem was obvious from the start. With the original Babysitter's Club series still ongoing, the California Diaries could not violate the Groundhog Day timeline of the BSC universe, whose characters were not permitted to age past eighth grade. The California Diaries got around this, sort of, with the belabored premise that Dawn and her California friends were transferred from their overcrowded middle school building to a high school building, which placed them in tantalizing proximity to high schoolers. With the main characters permanently stunted at age 13, though, the dramatic potential was severely curtailed. Alcohol was consumed, but never by the first person narrator, who could only look on disapprovingly until the drinking was punished. There was no problem that could not be solved by confiding in a trusted adult, except when Sonny Winslow's mom died of cancer, but that wasn't sexy. No one even kissed with tongue. Amid all this, there was Ducky McCrae, the only boy in the core cast. He hung out with Dawn and her fellow eighth graders because his peers bullied him. You might expect this arrangement to generate some romantic tension, but Ducky's relationship with the girls was purely platonic. He went shopping with them. He listened sympathetically to their chaste dating dilemmas and had none of his own. It's difficult to describe Ducky without sounding like I'm speaking in coy euphemisms, flapping my wrists suggestively as if trying to talk over the heads of children. He was sensitive, if you know what I mean. He enjoyed fashion and Broadway musicals, if you know what I mean. He was just one of the girls, if you know what I mean. Not that there's anything wrong with that. Have you ever played Taboo? It's a card-based party game in the tradition of charades. You draw a card with a secret word on it, say mustard, and you must convey this word to the group without uttering it or any of the related forbidden words on the card. Yellow, condiment, spread, Dijon, hot dog. You can't say any of that. It's a flavor agent used on grilled meats and a weaponized gas in World War I, you sputter until someone shouts mustard or time runs out. Reading the California Diaries is like an endless game of Taboo in which the secret word is always gay and time always runs out. The series liked to use wimp as a stand-in for the unsayable word. For example, at the climax of Ducky Diary 1, Ducky is taunted by a male classmate who says, quote, "You can't change, can you? I give you all these chances to be a normal guy, and what do? act like a wimp. Maybe that's the way you are, huh? Maybe there's a reason you can't meet girls. Maybe I'm wasting my breath and all these guys are right about you. The bully is quickly cut off before he can specify what exactly all these guys are speculating. Reading about Ducky felt like trying to hear my favorite song on a just out of range radio station, waiting anxiously for the static to clear. I was beginning to suspect that the unspeakable G word might apply to me, and I kept careful track of books that dared to deploy it. In the entire Animorphs series, it appeared exactly twice, a minimal gesture, but it rocked my world. It's a major reason I remember Animorphs so fondly, and a major reason I soured on Anne M. Martin. If nerdy old Animorphs could say the word, was it too much to hope that the sexy California Diaries would go there? It was. Ducky was never allowed to figure out why he was so different from the other guys. Ducky Diary 3 is the final book in the series. It ends unresolved with Ducky at a bookstore examining a collection of poetry, and he narrates, "It's a mix, Whitman, Adrienne Rich, and Baudelaire. Maybe I'll have to check them out sometime." That's the end of the quote. "Come on, Whitman," I imagine the ghostwriters shouting in a last desperate attempt to win this unwinnable game of taboo. "Fucking Adrienne Rich!" But that clue was too esoteric for me at age 13. Who was it intended for? Who was any of it intended for? If this thwarted coming out narrative was meant as a coded reassurance for readers like me, it failed. For my tween self, Ducky McCrae never inspired hope or courage or anything but despair. On the other hand, he's never left me. I remember Christy Thomas as a frustrating character in a book series I read a lifetime ago, but I remember Ducky McCrae as if he were a real guy I used to know. Every now and then, I even catch myself wondering what became of him. Did he ever come out? Is he happier now? No, of course not. He's trapped forever, along with the rest of the Babysitter's Club, in the hetero hellscape of the Scholastic Industrial Complex. Or perhaps I'm only projecting. Perhaps some part of me is still holding Ducky Diary 3 in my hands, studying the page where Ducky is studying the poetry book in his own hands, the two of us a recursive image of kid readers in the 90s, searching for something that can't speak its name. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Frankie. That was so awesome. So happy to have that piece as part of this book. Our next reader is SIOBHAN GALLAGHER. SIOBHAN is a Canadian visual storyteller illustrating the nuances of life through humor and sly observations. She is the author of In a Day's Work and Who Do You Think You Are, as well as a humor contributor to The New Yorker. She has had work featured in The New York Times, CBC, Elle Canada, and Us Weekly, and in 2017 received the Society of Illustrators Silver Medal of Excellence. Welcome, SIOBHAN.
Yay, thank you. So I don't have an essay, I have some visuals to show you. I did a few drawings kind of interpreting the members of the Babysitter's Club and where are they now as adults, and titled this series The Jaded Quitters Club, because I imagine maybe they grew up to be not as ambitious and cool as they were as 12-year-olds. So I'll do an old school show and tell here. The first one is Dawn's misguided power move, and she is getting a face tattoo of little stars. The second one is Jesse and the gang workshop a passive-aggressive text to an ex. So the gang's all back together and they're putting their efforts towards the important business. Next, there's Marianne's big test, and she is buying a pregnancy test. And the last one I actually made postcards of, so I'll show the color version. Stacy and her newly invalid health insurance. And there she is with her 26th birthday cake. So yeah, those are my little contributions, and thank you.
Thank you,
Thanks, Siobhan. I'll post the link to those postcards in the chat in a moment. Next up is Chante Griffin. Chante Griffin is a Los Angeles-based journalist whose work centers the intersection of race, culture, and faith. Her articles, essays, and interviews have appeared in nearly 50 publications, including The Root, The Washington Post, and The Los Angeles Times. Chante teaches writers and entrepreneurs how to write for the media through her courses on Teachable, and in her free time, she enjoys creating comedic content about her natural hair journey for the gram, and that is at kinky_coily_comedy. Hi, Chante.
Hello, how are you?
Good, thank you for being here.
Thank you for having me. Oh my goodness, those drawings were amazing. That pregnancy test one, I was on the floor laughing. So thank you all for that. The title of my essay is Jesse on the Margins, Black Characters Then and Now. I remember the day my boxed set of the Babysitter's Club books arrived. It was my sixth grade culmination, and I was adorned in my Sunday best, a flower dress my mother had sewn that was covered with pink and lavender flowers, cream stockings, and black patent leather heels. They were my first pair of heels, and you couldn't tell me that I wasn't grown and gorgeous in those 1-inch block heels. After the ceremony and the obligatory photos with my familial entourage, my teacher, a blonde white woman with short hair, came running towards my family, arms flapping to get our attention. These just arrived in the mail. Reading the books that summer felt like as much of a treat as the cherry flavored popsicles my little sister and I licked in the California sunshine. In my mind, Christy, Marianne, Stacy, and Claudia were my BFFs, even without the matching heart necklaces to prove it. When Mallory and Jesse joined the club, I embraced them too. But something didn't sit right with me about Jesse, even though we both had moved to neighborhoods and schools where we were suddenly one of the few Black kids, and even though we were both experiencing racism for the first time at those schools. My preteen self couldn't articulate what I now recognize as an adult, that the series depiction of Jesse's racial identity lacked the kind of cultural sophistication I needed as a young reader, especially as a young reader who was Black. In some ways, Jesse's inclusion in the series was ahead of its time, given the lack of diversity in children's and young adult literature. In other ways, it was also painfully reflective of that time. My angst with Jesse's character, though, started with her introduction in the book, Hello, Mallory. Although Mallory initially describes Jesse as beautiful, noting, quote, she was long-legged and thin, and even sitting down, she appeared graceful. Mallory also added in the book, also, she was Black. Wow, Mallory tells us, noting how few Black students there are in her school. This was pretty interesting. And while my 11-year-old self knew only that she didn't like that Jesse's presence was interesting, my adult self realizes that I wanted to meet Jesse first and any ensuing racism later. Throughout Hello, Mallory, it becomes painfully obvious that to some of the residents of Stony Brook, Blackness was the Black elephant in the room that they didn't know how to address directly, but that sometimes loomed as a source of discomfort. This was true even for Mallory and her more progressive family, who welcomed Jesse in ways their neighbors didn't. Mallory and Jesse's discussion about racism, the racism Jesse was experiencing in town, stood out. Quote, I don't belong in this school or even in this town. Neither does my family. You mean, Mallory says, you mean because you're you can say it, Jesse says, because we're Black. Looking back, I realized that Jesse's identity was steeped in race in ways the white characters' identities weren't. And back then, however, I didn't have the words to describe the discomfort I was experiencing or questions to challenge the author's logic. Were protagonists assumed to be white? If so, were they presumed to be white only by white readers or by all readers, was Anne M. Martin making Jesse accommodate the white gaze? In a 2016 article, The Pervasive Whiteness of Children's Literature, Collective Harms and Consumer Obligations, Bryn F. Welch writes that, quote, the pervasive whiteness, unquote, of children's literature feeds the idea that, quote, white is the norm or default, while other races are variations from that norm, unquote. An example she cites is how skin color gets described in many children's books. Here's another quote. White skin is the default and as such requires no special attention. Deviations from this default, however, require comment or explanation, unquote. This explains why I felt uncomfortable every time Jesse said, I'm Black, we're Black, and you should know that we're Black. All of these statements clearly, even if unintentionally, positioned Jesse as outside of the norm. And descriptions of Claudia mirrored this pattern too. Christy, Marianne, Stacy, Don, and Mallory were never similarly burdened with describing themselves as white. They lived fictional lives, unburdened by race. Welch observes that race often defines characters of color. It's this aspect of Jesse's construction that my 11-year-old self intuitively disliked. Because her introductory story into the series and resultant self-descriptions conspicuously centered her race while unintentionally positioning her on the margins, being Black then became a plot point she could never escape despite her varied babysitting adventures.
Thank you so much, Chante. That's so great. That piece is so fantastic and it's so powerful to hear you read it out loud. So we are going to have one more reader and then we're going to do a quick Q&A. So please go ahead and enter your questions for our readers in the chat and we will come back to those after our last reader, who is Myriam Gurba. Myriam is a writer and artist. She is the author of the true crime memoir, Mean, a New York Times editor's choice. Her essays and criticism have appeared in the Paris Review, Time.com, and Four Columns. She has shown art in galleries, museums, and community centers. She lives in Long Beach, California with herself. Welcome, Myriam.
Thank you. It's an honor to be here. And this is also just really, really fun and really exciting. And it's so great to share space with fellow Babysitters Club maniacs. And this series meant a lot to me when I was growing up. This series and then also the Anastasia Krupnik series were like my thing. Like, I loved those. So I'm gonna go ahead and read a little bit from my essay, which is titled Christie's Invisible Hand and Das Babysitters Club Kapital. And what I did was bring an analysis of Babysitters Club to the classroom and and I write a bit about my experiences as a teacher using Babysitter's Club. My first encounter with girls as ardent capitalists happened between the covers of Anne M. Martin's Babysitter's Club books. The original series totaled 131 installments, and from the series' first page, its entrepreneurial bent roared, quote, the Babysitter's Club. I'm proud to say it was totally my idea, even though the four of us worked it out together. Us is Marianne Spire, Claudia Kishi, Stacy McGill, and me, Christy Thomas, end quote. The series chronicled the fictional adventures of a marginally diverse girl collective in Stony Brook, Connecticut, as they grow and maintain a successful business. Common tween issues animated the series' capitalist story arcs. I don't remember how Christie's great idea landed in my lap, but once I devoured that debut, I needed more. Hooked, I hoarded my allowance and gophered into the couch seeking derelict change. I brought my sweaty coins to Armal's B. Dalton bookstore and exchanged pennies, quarters, and dimes for YA money-making thrills. As I acquired more books, I not only got to know the babysitters better, I felt I was making friends with them. Friends serve as mirrors. They show you who you are, and I saw aspects of myself keenly reflected by two particular Babysitters Club characters. I saw myself in Christy. She generated ideas, stuck to her guns, and gave orders. Her stubborn tomboyishness was my stubborn tomboyishness. I also developed a special affection for Claudia. Since she was the club's token girl of color until Jesse joined the group 13 books later as a junior member, I saw my Chicana self reflected in her, and Claudia's presence was so important to me, so magnetic, that I doubt I would have become as emotionally invested in the series as I became had all its characters been white. The babysitters inspired me, and Christie's entrepreneurial vision seemed plain yet elegant, easy to follow too. While watching her mother grapple with childcare issues, ingenuity strikes Christie. After finishing her homework, she sketches a business plan. She nominates her friends, Marianne and Claudia, as business partners. She decides that they'll advertise childcare services using flyers, the telephone, and the newspaper. The club will have set hours of operations during which clientele can call and book a sitter. To generate startup capital, each member will pay dues. I'm writing about the club using an economic lens because I earn my paycheck doing a fearsome thing. I teach high school economics. In class, I borrow from and build upon the economic models and lessons embedded in Babysitters Club books. During lectures, I refer to instances like Christie's entrepreneurial combination of land, labor, and capital. And one project that I assigned is directly inspired by the series. I invite students to work alone or with friends to develop a business plan. Once the plan for their sole proprietorship, partnership, or other organization has been researched and developed, they present it to their classmates and me. We respond with evaluations. My students' business plan presentations bring me joy that I was deprived of as a girl. When I tried becoming an entrepreneur, I crashed into what economists call barriers to entry. The primary barrier was bearded. I called it Dad. Dad was also part of the reason I unofficially resigned from the Girl Scouts. My best friend, a blonde tomboy, invited me to join her troop, and I attended only a few meetings before cookie selling season arrived. Like Christy, I'm the Babysitters Club president. I'm high key competitive. I enter contests to win, and our troop leader incentivized us to sell, 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 teasing us with a talc scented trophy, a Cabbage Patch Kids doll. This prize would be awarded to the brownie who sold the most sugar, and I had major ganas to be that girl, la ganadora. Crowds the world over were rioting for Cabbage Patch Kids. The toy trend had swept California too, and rumors featuring parents who mugged children and ran off with their dolls impressed me. Those are good parents, I thought to myself. They're adjusting to shortages with loving violence. I'll go ahead and stop there so that we can move on to the Q&A.
Thank you so much. I love that essay. So good.
Thank you so much, Miriam.
Okay, great. So we've got a couple of questions. Yeah, for our contributors, panelists, if you don't mind coming back on screen, that would be great so we can see everyone. Why don't we start with Sue's question, which Siobhan brought up again, just about, where did it go? Which character you identify as, or was your favorite, or you know, whatever you want to say about that kind of question. Would anyone like to start?
I feel like everyone's going to say Claudia because she's, she, I always like, I wanted to identify as her, but I feel like I was a Mallory and that bummed me out.
I obviously loved Claudia and felt like a little bit of a Claudia because, you know, I was very artistic, but I, as an adult, I can now, I now have the maturity to say that I also had really big Christy energy as a very bossy kid and also like big Janine energy as a very nerdy kid.
Yeah, I'll jump in and say, I just really identify with Christy so much. I mean, she always has ideas. She's starting something. All my friends and family who are on know I always have a new idea. But definitely, I think Jessie and just, she was just very ambitious and multi-talented. It's like, this week, Jessie's in the Olympics, and now Jessie won an award. You're like, what does Jessie do? So I think a combination of Christy and Jessie.
I think admitting that you're Mallory is like an acceptance process. Like you, you know, grow up enough to admit that. I wanted to be like Stacy and be cool and live in New York, but I'm 40 and finally adult enough to admit I'm Mallory.
Yeah, Gabby, I love your piece about how we're all Mallorys. So good.
Mallory repression. Let it free.
Well, I'm going to go ahead and name a babysitter that no one has mentioned yet, which is pretty cool for me. I wanted to lie because this is really unflattering to me, but for some reason, from the first grade onward, my very favorite character, the one whose books I collected and thought about all the time, was fucking Marianne. I cannot explain why, maybe because we both had brown hair and I didn't like Christy, so that left Marianne. And I have been ashamed of this for years and years and years because Marianne is such a boring choice. And like, why did I aspire to be the shy one who cries a lot beyond the fact that I am shy and I cry a lot? But you know what? The Netflix Babysitter's Club show has such a cool Marianne. She's beautiful and she's a theater kid like me. So she has single-handedly redeemed Marianne for me. And I am slightly less embarrassed now that my answer is Marianne.
Marianne is pretty amazing, to be honest.
No, she's not. Come on.
I feel I was a Marianne hater as a child, but I think it's because I didn't want to admit that I saw myself in Marianne too, because she's kind of like quiet and shy and cries a lot.
Okay, the thing you just described, literally what you just described is the quality of being uncool.
All the babysitters bring something to the table. Do you know what I mean? That's like the kaleidoscopic beauty of like the characters. But I kind of went already because like, you know, that it was in my piece that like Claudia was a big draw for me. And then Christy's bossiness. Like I loved it. I was like, oh, another bossy girl. So that was what hooked me.
We had a couple of other really great questions here. Let's see, from Matt. For anyone, was it tough to balance being critical of the book series that you love? Anyone have any responses?
For me personally, I had to work hard to be more forgiving toward the book series. I have nothing but irritation when I look back at the Babysitter's Club, which was why I had to really... remind myself that Anne M. Martin is not personally responsible for homophobia. I don't know. I feel I have so much resentment towards those books. And I know this is a me problem and it's irrational, but no, I had completely the opposite problem. I just want to bully the Babysitter's Club and shove them in a locker.
I mean, I'll say, you know, I really had a hard time writing the critique just because it felt like you're writing something that you know the person you're critiquing is going to read, right? And so that's just very intimidating. Like, here are all the ways you screwed it up. P.S. I love you, you know? So I really had to learn how to speak the truth and to speak it completely, but hopefully gracefully or graciously. So it was really like, I had to call my friend Jody. She had to like talk me through it. And I'm like crying, just because I think confronting people, especially in such a public way, takes a lot of gall, right? It takes a lot of strength. And I feel this a lot of times if I'm writing something and I know it's for public consumption, I know there's going to be pushback, right? I have to really be resolved in what I'm saying. So it was a growth experience for me, honestly.
Yeah, I mean, I think I wrestled with that also in the essay and then also the documentary, talking about the ways in which, you know, for as much as Claudia really broke a lot of stereotypes about Asian Americans and non-white characters, you know, she was also described as exotic. She also, you know, always had the almond-shaped eyes. And, you know, like you mentioned, she also, like Jesse, had to deal with racism in a way that was kind of in a kind of, you know, one book, one racist member of the neighborhood and not any sort of structural thing. And, you know, something that none of the other members had to deal with either. And I think it's just a balancing act of, you know, definitely acknowledging that the books were really inclusive and progressive for the time. And I think did a lot for writing about all different kinds of kids from, you know, differently abled kids or kids of different classes, kids of different backgrounds, in a way that did overall make them seem like just part of the neighborhood, you know? And I think that was something that a lot of people were hungry for at the time, even like, you know, kids with divorced parents or things like that, that seem more normalized today. But at the same time, recognizing that, you know, it was a different time. I think conversations about race and representation have really progressed a lot. And I think now we rightfully ask for more. But I think it's a good, having those discussions is a good foundation for thinking about, well, what do we want now from stories, right? What do we have now? And what do we demand now that we didn't used to have?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Really great responses. Okay, this question from Brooke. Did anyone get a bad haircut, wear a ridiculous outfit, or develop a weird tic, like knocking on walls to check for secret doors in your childhood, thanks to the BSC?
Looking for the secret passageway? Is that what that is?
I definitely tried to like get a bunch of little candy bars and hide them like for later, like Claudia, but it never lasted. I was always just like, they're in my pillowcase. Okay, I'm just going to eat them now.
Yeah, I had a lot of like thrift store buys that I was going to, you know, like do something cool with that just, you know, like I would like cut them up and then be like, this isn't what I imagined this would be.
Christy Thomas gave me the misconception that it is a very funny, cool thing to do to make fun of the food in the cafeteria and talk about how gross it looks and that your friends think you're so funny when you do this. And because I'm very awkward, it took me an embarrassingly long time to notice that my friends really did not appreciate it. And when they told me to stop, it wasn't like a cute, fun thing. It was like, actually, I was really annoying them. So screw you, Christy. That's not funny. And you were a bad role model to me.
Amazing. Any other... important influential moves that you made in childhood due to the BSC?
I mean, just starting clubs for me, like I definitely, yes. And I continue to start clubs, clubs. But let's move on to this last question and then we'll wrap up. This is from Erica. How do you think series like BSC or Sweet Valley High help to shape how we see modern YA? Gabby, I feel like this is calling your name.
Ooh, I mean, big question. That is much of what my book Paperback Crush is about. I think the can't think on my feet. They shaped modern YA. You know, so much of modern YA has been a reaction, you know, a reaction to the last wave, a reaction to the last wave. And so, you know, I think a lot of the YA we had maybe for the previous decade was still the reaction to the BSC, and it shaped it in that way. But now we're at the point where so many people who grew up with it, you know, so many YA writers now grew up reading the Babysitter's Club. And so I think, you know, it influences it. Obviously, this book is a sign of that, you know, adults who are making and creating things are, I'm sucking at this. Anyone else, anyone please, giving the floor.
One of the things that comes up in your essay is just the emphasis on friendship. the BSC kind of inaugurated within the genre. Go ahead.
Oh, I think the BSC created sort of the, or helped popularize the friendship genre of YA books since before Babysitter's Club, sort of during the reign of Sweet Valley. So much YA was romance, and so much stuff prior to that, you know, you could find books about individual, you know, two girls who were friends. There was no sense of that, you know, women could form a community to support each other. And so, but that might be one of the most lasting impacts of the Babysitter's Club, that it brought that into mainstream, super commercial YA. And that, I think it's really stayed there.
Any other thoughts on that question? Okay, well, we can wrap up. We're at our hour. Thank you so much, everyone.
Yeah, thanks so much to all of our readers. You all are amazing. Thank you again to Green Apple and to Erica for hosting. Thank you all for coming. So excited to be able to celebrate this book with you all.
Thank you all for tuning in, and thank you all for sharing your contributions to We Are the Babysitters Club. Everyone in the audience, you can come in store to get your copy or order online at greenapplebooks.com. Forever a classic. All right. Okay. Have a good night, everyone.
Yeah. Thanks again. Bye.
Bye.